Welcome, everybody, to our 100-Year Lifestyle Podcast, where we are definitely transforming health and longevity worldwide so that you and your loved ones can live at 100% for 100 years and beyond. And we're going to talk with a courageous woman today about her book, Safe and Effective. Caitlin, welcome.
Thank you very much. It's an honor to be here. Super excited to be able to have someone to chat with and can't wait to see what we each know and share our knowledge.
Oh, yeah. Well, you know, I love the title of your book, Safe and Effective. And here's my favorite part, by the way, the subheading of it, Why Medical Freedom is Worth Fighting For. And, you know, you don't look like a warrior necessarily on the outside, but you got some toughness on the inside. I could tell just in our preliminary discussions. How did you get into this conversation? Which, by the way, Caitlin, her book is out. It's called Safe and Effective, Why Medical Freedom is Worth Fighting For. She is a registered nurse. She comes from a medical background. I'm not going to tell you any more about her because her story is very relevant to why she's doing what she's doing. So Caitlin, have at it, girl.
Yeah, thanks. Great question. So I would like to say it was 1 minute I was totally enlightened, but it was a little bit of a journey. So I entered nursing school and I loved it. I knew I wanted to be in healthcare. I'd been in healthcare my whole life. My family, they're all nurses. And so went to nursing school, did great, got out on the other side, and started to explore some other avenues. My husband was starting chiropractic college, and we were excited about that and just exploring a lot of the other avenues of healthcare. And so I was talking about how we could raise a happy family. And with nursing, I knew there were a million avenues to go. So I enrolled in a lactation educator course. I'm like, this will be an awesome skill set to add. And so I sat down at the course and everyone around there, I mean, on paper, I had the greatest credentials. I had had 2 bachelor's degrees, and these women sat down and they started talking about delayed cord clamping and water bursts and just some things that I wasn't exposed to ever. And I was like, what's delayed cord clamping? And they were like, oh, you don't know? And so it kind of opened my eyes that what I had learned in nursing school wasn't necessarily what the literature was saying was the best for mom and baby. And maybe our hospital births weren't how they should be. And maybe we were opening this cascade of interventions that didn't necessarily need to be opened. And so I had this moment where I was like, wow, maybe I missed that day. I didn't, but I just was really confused with how the literature was so different from what I had been taught in school. And so I just kind of continued exploring other options and found a lot in the toxicity world. And we started to look into environmental toxins in our house and cleaning products and my makeup and my shampoo. And then my eyes were opened in that realm. And same thing with nutrition and the benefit of organics and GMOs and glyphosate. And it just opened my eyes to this huge world that maybe we were doing something wrong. And why wasn't I able to find this information?
And yeah, so, and let me just chime in real quick. I met you through a mutual friend and an organization, Moms Across America, that is doing a great job. We're doing a lot of work with them moving forward because a lot of moms are in the same position that you are, where you want answers and you're not happy with the answers that you're getting out in the world. And Zen and her team and all of the moms across America that are a part of that, they're hungry for the information and they're driving this movement that's happening. The moms are driving this movement out in the world. So I love that we have that connection too.
Absolutely. And I will definitely come back to Moms Across America because they have been another pivotal moment of my life and everything that I do. But just in exploring our world of toxins, then we came across vaccines and I didn't have any kids at the time. But I wanted to know more. I bought Dr. Bob Sears's The Vaccine book and opened it, read a little bit, was so overwhelmed by it and was just like, it goes against everything I have been ingrained with. It was honestly just overwhelming. So I closed the book and I didn't come back to it for a year until we started to have our own kids. And once you have your own baby and you look at them in the face and you are the only person in the world that can make decisions for them at that time, it was like sink or swim. And I either have to learn or I might live a life of regret. And so we worked really hard to find a quote unquote natural pediatrician who would work with Dr. Bob Sears' schedule and answered the questions in the right way and knew that there was aluminum and other things. So I'm like, okay, we're on a great path. But every time I went to the pediatrician's office, I just had this feeling that I was doing something wrong and it wouldn't go away. I cried in her office multiple times. They brought in the MA to come sit with me and just try and make me feel better and try and make me go through the protocols that they wanted, but it was just something in me I knew was wrong. And so I started to ask questions and we scheduled another appointment just to talk. And she sat down and said, I don't think you're the right fit for me as a patient. So I will help you find another pediatrician if you need to, but it's not going to be me. So that was
lucky for you.
It was the greatest blessing. Yeah. I mean, honestly, it really was. At the time, you're just devastated. You're a new mom. I had a new baby. And the one person I was supposed to be able to turn to get answers said, I'm sorry, I'm not going to. And so then it was like, there must be more to this story. Why? You are the one person that's supposed to be trained and trustworthy, and I hand over my tiny baby to you, and you just violated my trust by not answering my questions.
Yeah, so, you know, I find it interesting. You as a nurse, you went to school. You obviously are diligent. You did your work. You're well-read. That continued after you got out of nursing school. It didn't change. Obviously, you are who you are. You take yourself wherever you go. And so here you were seeking answers. You were learning about questions that you should ask. And you got fired. And I think that from your pediatrician, I think why these conversations are so important is a lot of moms are being bullied by pediatricians today. And so, I mean, in your community, in your work, as you learned about this information that's in your book and what you talked about with your husband, which is an also interesting story about how you learned about us for the first time.
Yeah. So we are, before I became a human mom, I was a dog mom, still am a dog mom. And we have two Rhodesian Ridgebacks and they're amazing and we love them, but we are very active people and we hike a lot and they do a lot. And, we think that dogs deserve the same quality of care that we do. And so we take our dogs to chiropractors and my husband wasn't trained at the time. And so we, showed up at, she covers, I think, the Stanford horses, and she had this great resume and everyone referred to, this doctor in California. And so we took our dogs and we walked in and there was 100-year lifestyle all over. And myself and my husband were like, what is this? And so she had books and posters and all this stuff. And we,
Dr. Jamie, she's great. And she's in what city is it? It's
Los Altos. Yeah.
Very cool. And so, all right. So now let's get back to it. Now you are, don't have a pediatrician.
Right. So we just, I went on Google. I went on Dr. Sears's website. And at this point I wasn't big on social media. So I didn't understand. I just felt like I was hitting my head against a wall, trying to find information I could not find. And granted, this was 5 years ago. And I think that we've come a long way in the movement to access to information. And so I think that that's been extraordinarily helpful, but had I known of groups, it would have been way easier to do, but I went on Dr. Sears's website and there were a couple, maybe it was NBIC, Barbara Fisher's organization. And I think there was a list and I just started going down the list. Like, are you taking new patients? Are you taking new patients? Are you taking new patients? I got a lot of no's. And then finally, she's like, no, I'm at my wit's end. I need somebody. You don't even have to see my child, but will you sit down for an hour with me and talk about vaccines? And she said, sure. It'll be a regular office visit though. I said, fine. I need someone who will answer these questions for me. And so she's like, well, just bring your kid along just in case, like, and make sure my one caveat is that your husband needs to be there as well. I'm like, that's weird. She's like, well, I'm going to interview both parents before I accept any new patients. I might make an exception. You're in healthcare. I want to help you out. And so she interviewed myself and my husband separately because she is so guarded with her own license that if you have parents that aren't on board, she was backed into this corner that she now has to vet patients that are actively seeking her before she feels comfortable to treat, which is, it's horrible for healthcare. Like, where are we headed if that's what's happening?
You know, it is, yes. And at the same time, it's vital today. I mean, the reality of it is you were both vetting each other. You were vetting her and she was vetting you and everybody was vetting everybody because, you know, what I appreciate about what you have been saying so far is that you are taking a stand for your child. You're responsible for your child. The state's not going to come in and monitor everything in your family, unless obviously the world changes even worse than where it's going. But the reality of it is right now, you're the one that's got to live with the consequences of your choices. The pediatrician doesn't have to live with the consequences of your choices. And that's important for every parent that's listening right now. And so I'm curious, what were some of the questions that you were asking and what were some of the questions that the pediatrician asked you?
Yeah. So, well, the biggest question I asked, the reason we got fired from our first pediatrician is I said, I was reading the package insert on the Tdap vaccine and a fifth dose is required, but it says it only, and granted this was 5 years ago, so please forgive my numbers by a few margins, but I think it increased efficacy like maybe 2 to 5%, but the adverse reaction rate went up exponentially between the fourth and the fifth dose. And I was like, can I just not give the fifth? And she's like, no. It's like, I'm sorry, what? And she's like, well, no, I'm not really not comfortable giving up the fifth. I don't think we're a good fit. And I was like, okay, well, if you won't let me give up the fifth, then you certainly won't let me give up the fourth, third, second, first. And so that was just the next question that I asked the next pediatrician. I was like, what if I choose to go this route, can I not do the fifth? It doesn't really make sense. And she's like, yeah, but if you want to look at the fifth dose, we should probably look at the fourth, third, second, first, and kind of see what those are and kind of talk about your comforts. And so I was like, okay. Happy she was open to that and going that route. And then she just started to go in a lot. For her vetting us, it was what were my views and then what were my husband's views, and if it came to it and something was mandated, what would my family do? And she wanted to know, if we took it to the worst case scenario in this world, what would we do? And my husband and I both at the same time said we'd move. There were certain things that are not going to be imposed on our family, and we will stand strong, and I might have to move, you know, 50 times in my life, but first and foremost, it is my kids. And she's like, okay, I'll take you as a patient. And so that was like her one question that made her feel comfortable with us, that like, we are committed to our kids no matter what. And if you're willing to leave the state, then she's happy to take us.
Well, I love the journey. I love your courage and your husband's courage that you did it together. I think that's really important. You know, way back when Lisa and I were making our decision, this is going back 31 years ago, 31 and a half years ago, we were crazy people. There was like nobody else like us except for maybe some other colleagues. But now, thankfully, more and more people are reading books like yours. More and more people are becoming aware. They're waking up to these realities. And so here you are, you're asking the questions that are similar questions that are asked in the movie, The Act, which shows the journey of parents that are finding out that they're having a baby and they want to know, you know, they want to learn more. They want to learn. They just don't want to be sheep and line up and put their kids at risk and put their entire rest of their life at risk with these mandates and these vaccine schedules. So what were some of the most shocking things that you learned along the way as you, and some of them are in your book. So a lot of what you hear Caitlin talk about are going to be in her book. It's a really easy read. It's short. It's big print. You can read it fast. It's referenced and it's coming from a nurse's perspective, which I think is so important. Without, you know, there's a lot of medical errors, a ridiculous number of medical errors. They keep changing the amount. 400,000 a year is the last number I read. And it would be like 1 million a year if it wasn't for nurses. So thanks to people like you that are watching the backs of the patients when nobody else is looking, by the way.
Yeah, do our best, definitely. The biggest thing for me, or the greatest eye-opener, was just the hepatitis B vaccine. And I remember asking, I've worked in healthcare, and so I was asking the physician that I worked for at the time, and I was like, why do we give this on day one? And he's like, oh, I don't know. I was like, oh, he had already had a couple kids. And I'm like, you didn't ask why? He's like, oh, no. And so it really opened my eyes, because hepatitis B, as we all know, is commonly a sexually transmitted disease, or needle sharing behaviors that our infantile population is not engaging in 100%. I'm grateful for modern medicine. We can screen for hepatitis B, but even so, if you have a hepatitis B positive mom, the vaccine isn't the answer for the kid. There's a lot of other therapies that have to go into it. And so also our hepatitis B rates are extraordinarily low in the United States. And so it's like, why an hour after birth are we doing this to these babies? And nobody had the answer. And you dig a little bit deeper and it's like, well, compliance is really low. And so we might as well get it when we have an opportunity. And I'm like, an opportunity that is not for the betterment of the child. And our entire parenting philosophy is it easier for me or is it easier for my kid? And I'm the only person that can provide for my babies at this time. And so my goal is to set them up in the most successful way possible. Jeez. And I'm not doing a vaccine out of convenience for the healthcare system. That's not how parenting should be. And so that was just a big aha moment. And then you look into the ingredients and we start to go into the aluminum load and then what the FDA safe level is for ingestion, not even injection. And for our 5 kilogram babies, we're already, you know, exponentially over the maximum load for aluminum in a single dose being injected, not ingested. And so you just, once you learn something, you can't unlearn it and you can't walk
and
away.
And once you inject something, you can't take it out.
You can't at all. And so it's just like, if we've messed up on the very first one, how can you trust the rest of the schedule or the rest of the system not to be for the betterment of my baby? Like, again, it just comes back to the kids and we need to protect them and we need to not do it because some higher power told us to. We need to do it because it's for the betterment of the kids. And I haven't found that to be true thus far.
So in nursing school, I'm just curious, did you study vaccines in nursing school? Did they give you any courses in it? Did they tell you why it was beneficial? Did they tell you that there were any possible adverse effects of vaccinations? Or, I mean, what did you get in nursing school? I'm curious.
Yeah, it less than medical doctors, which is close to next to nothing. And so we just learned that there's a schedule and you follow the schedule and you get them at your regular pediatric appointments. There's a catch-up schedule if you need it, and that's kind of the extent of it.
They never taught you about the ingredients. They never taught you about the potential side effects, potential risks.
No.
They never talked to you about that there haven't really been any double-blind placebo-based studies, and nobody really thought to ask.
No.
Everybody just kind of followed along. Because I think a lot of people, when they engage in this conversation, they don't understand how the educational process is for doctors and nurses. They think that, wow, they're studying all the science and it's all the latest information, when the reality of it is that's not true.
Not at all. You don't touch on ingredients. I didn't even know about like the injury compensation programs. I didn't know about quote unquote vaccine court. I didn't learn about any of that until after school when I actively was seeking the information. But I didn't even know that you could report an event or that there was a table of injuries. And there's just so much information, but it's so hard to find. And I'm so grateful that the movement is growing and that we have Moms Across America and Children's Health Defense and the High Wire who are big players in disseminating information and are doing it effectively, because there's so many people out there seeking this information, but it's so hard to find. And when you're a mom with a new baby and you're just trying to learn it on your phone while your baby's nursing, because that's all the time you have, it just makes it extraordinarily challenging. And so I think we need to work really hard to bridge this knowledge gap between the general population and the people that have been able to find it. And that was a big reason I made my book as small and as short as I did, because when I was going through this journey, you find all this information and then you try to regurgitate it to somebody who's questioning your parenting and you feel attacked and you're like, how do I tell them the breadth of information I have in a clear and concise way that they will actually listen to that? There's phenomenal literature out there in this community. And Suzanne Humphreys has great books, but they are long and they are intense, and they need to be, because the credibility is there and the references are there. But we also need to be able to communicate with people in a very short, clear, concise way to say, maybe you should look more into this. And so my goal was to give a cliff notes that people could do a really quick read. If you don't have an hour of your time to hear where I'm coming from, then I should probably be talking to somebody else. But like, I hope you respect me enough to take an hour of your day to learn something about me that I'm so passionate about. So that's kind of my goal, is just bridging this knowledge gap, because the information was just so hard for me to find. And it was such a dark time in my life that I don't want other people to feel as isolated as I did.
Well, it is great that people, when they hear this story, they know that they're not alone and that you are not a bad parent because you're asking questions. You're actually a good parent because you're asking questions and you're becoming aware. And so let's fly through some of the cliff notes, okay?
Yeah.
So that people that are listening to this can really get a sense of, what do I need to know? What do I want to study more? What chapter should I go to when I get the book, et cetera? So I'm looking at it right now. So the first thing that I want to talk about is a lot of people don't really understand what's behind the vaccine industry, that what that vaccine industry is really all about. It is not the altruistic industry. It is the injury. It is not the altruistic industry that people think it is. So talk about that, because I think that's a big wake-up call for a lot of moms and parents.
Yeah. And so we, as a society, have been ingrained to put so much trust into the pharmaceutical industry, because so many people nowadays have or need or think they need a medication for X, Y, and Z problems. And so the use of drugs, medications, and vaccines are now called biologics are, it's so prevalent in society that it kind of gets diluted that we are administering medications or at least, I mean, anything. So when we give a vaccine, it's so commonplace that you stop questioning it. And we see medication ads 24/7, TV, magazines, all this. And so it just, if you take a step back, makes you realize how big the industry is. And we're talking billions of dollars annually go into these industries and information's getting disseminated. But the scary part is the industry is actually really small. So their dollar amount's really big, but there's only a few big players that are making vaccines. And their goal, as with any business, is profit. And so just because they're making a medication that in their eyes is going to help society, it doesn't take away the fact that they are there to make money. And when you have a product that then we take away liability because we've had so many adverse reactions, which is what happened in about 1986, there were so many vaccine adverse reactions that the US government has now assumed responsibility for adverse reactions. And so this industry became liability free. And after you take liability or checks and balances away from a system, you can kind of run wild. And so we saw an explosion with how many vaccines are in the pipelines now, because it is such a money market. You don't have to advertise because the government does it for you by putting it on the schedule. You don't have to be liable for it. If you make a bad batch, if you have a contamination, if your doctor injects the wrong vaccine, nobody's liable for it. The only person that comes back on is the parent of that child. And so we've just lost the ability to have a checks and balances. And again, like I said, it's just billions of dollars going into this, because once you mandate it, if that's where we're headed, or even just put it on the schedule, you have a market pool that is so large that your earning potential is just unheard of. And so why, if you were a pharmaceutical company, would you not want to capitalize on that? And it's all just at the sacrifice of our kids.
Yeah, it's evil. And you know, what really concerns me is I've been saying for a while, where have all the doctors gone? Where have all the pediatricians gone? Because, I mean, the reality of it is we have the most neurologically damaged children ever in the history of the world. The numbers are rising like crazy, and new conditions, new neurologically damaged conditions are being named all the time. And it's so scary, because you'd think that they would speak up. It's really, in my mind, I mean, and I'm not judging all of the pediatricians that are out there. I think they're powerless in the pressure that they're feeling from the world and from their peers. But, you know, where have all the human beings gone that are chosen to become pediatricians? They need to speak up more than ever, because, you know, you mentioned something. You talk about the National Vaccine Injury Compensation Program, which I want you to mention that, and the adverse reactions reporting, which those two are related in a way that I think are really important. Let's talk about them. You describe what they are, and then I'm going to give you my two cents on the combination of those things.
I would love to hear it. And this is something I'm so passionate about, because it just fries me. We have a National Vaccine Injury Compensation Program. So anytime anybody gets injected with a vaccine, a percentage of the cost of that vaccine goes into a fund in which we will pay out later to kids that are injured by vaccines or adults. So we essentially are preloading the pool that we need to pay for vaccine damage later. And the fact that we have to have that shows us something is wrong. But the National Vaccine Injury Compensation Program is very challenging to navigate to begin with, but what happens is you have a vaccine, and then if you have an adverse reaction, you tell your pediatrician in theory, and then they go on to report it. Well, most vaccine reactions are only suggested to be reported, and there's only a few that are mandated, and that comes from something called the Table of Injuries. And the Table of Injuries is something that the government set forth with known adverse vaccine reactions. And so say you have something like chickenpox, you can have certain reactions to that, or seizure is a common one that we see in this. And so seizure can be known, and it'll say, oh, a seizure between 3 and 6 days post-administration of this disease. And if you have that, that must be reported. And we stand on this reporting system as a safety guard for, well, we're doing follow-up testing to make sure that vaccines are safe. And so the thing is that the table of injuries is very limited. And for most vaccines, there's only 2 to 4 adverse reactions listed on that with a very specific time frame. So say it's chickenpox and you have a seizure and it says between day 3 and 6, but your seizure happened on day 2, it doesn't have to be reported and it never happened. Or say that you have transverse myelitis, because we're hearing that come up with the COVID vaccine. Well, that wasn't on the table of injuries, so it never has to be reported. So you will never be compensated by the Vaccine Injury Compensation Program, and it will never be associated with that vaccine because it wasn't on the table of injuries. And this is unique because we'll never grow the table of injuries, and so we'll never see increased number of adverse reactions because we have put that pool so small into what can happen. We're not looking for anything else. We're only looking for what we know. And so we'll never grow, we'll never make them safer, and we'll never truly see what the adverse reaction rates are, because it doesn't have to be reported if it's not one of those 2 to 4 things that was already listed.
Yeah, and so do we know the number of adverse reactions that are actually reported percentage-wise? Is that number even, can it be even calculated?
So it's reported that it's about 1%, or 1% of adverse reactions ever get reported. I have seen data that said up to 10% of adverse reactions ever get reported, but most things point to 1% of adverse reactions ever get reported.
Okay, and so there have been, the last number that I saw was over $4 billion that have been paid out by this vaccine injury compensation. And isn't there a maximum amount for each injury that is allowed to be paid for each injury?
There is a maximal allotment, yes. But the tricky thing with all of these reporting things is once you go through the National Vaccine Injury Compensation Program and you go to quote unquote vaccine court, it's not really court, but, or try and have your own trial, which is a whole nother story. None of that information is public record. And so you can't see what someone was awarded. You can't see what went into that lawsuit. You can't see the literature that they used to substantiate their claim. Every person going through that has to start at square one, and you can't use any preceding information in order to go forward, which is not true in our normal judiciary system. You can use preceding cases in order to substantiate yours, and that sets the current of the law. But with vaccines, we have eliminated that entirely, and every person starts at square one.
Yeah, and so if you think about that number, 1%, if 1% is reported and that's the number, and it's $4 billion, then we're really looking at $400 billion, or if it's 10%, it's maybe $40 billion, between $40 and $400 billion that would be paid out, and that's just on a very obviously small percentage. And that's a, breaks my heart for these families, because, you know, we did a podcast interview with a woman from Ohio. It's a great podcast, and it's about autistic moms speaking out. And, you know, she said, and I really love what she says, and I hate that she had to say it, but she's like, you know, I did what the doctors told me to do. I did what the CDC told me to do. And these doctors, the patients, I mean, these numbers are staggering numbers of children that are having adverse reactions and neurological damage. And they're walking into these offices. You'd think that these pediatricians would be screaming out at the top of their lungs on behalf of families.
Yeah, you would. And you would hope that they would. And I lived in California at the time of SB 276, which was, you know, its own fiasco. But I went to the Capitol and I was at those rallies and I was talking to politicians and trying to do everything that I could. And part of the hearing that undergoes is you can stand up and you can say if you're for or against. And when I showed up to those events, it was astonishing how many physicians showed up in favor of the bill. And I was like, well, where are the ones against it? And few showed up, but you almost get crucified as a physician if you start to speak against mainstream medicine. And then I'm like, well, who are all these physicians that are so strongly for it? Well, it turns out most of them are medical students. And so they would go to the med colleges and say, can you guys show up at the Capitol and show your presence and just say like, hey, I'm so-and-so, I'm a doctor, I'm for. And you just do this line after line after line after line. And it was just heartbreaking to see, because it is only a small number of physicians that are fighting these bills because they're scared to, they have to protect their license. My pediatrician in California got a threatening letter from the board that she had to hire attorneys to interpret. And there was no punitive actions, nothing negative coming out, but it's just threats. And it keeps people or providers at bay, because you work really hard to become a medical doctor. Your entire career stands on it, and you don't want to lose your license. And there is threat of loss of licensure for even just speaking against it, or, you know, writing a vaccine exemption on a child that genuinely deserves one. But we're starting to just limit the scope of medicine and turn it to the hand of the state. And I'm sorry, but I don't think somebody who's never met my child, who's a politician or, you know, hired by a politician, should be the one deciding if my child needs a vaccine or not. That's just not how medicine should work.
Yeah, it's true. And, you know, if you're listening to this and you're a parent, it is a little scary what we're talking about here. And the reason why it's a little scary, to be honest, is that it's really scary. And but to be not have the knowledge and to not know how to speak about it and to be afraid to speak out because you'll be ridiculed. I think this is why this is such an important conversation. I mean, here, you're an ordinary parent, just like I was an ordinary parent, and we did the homework, and it sure beats being an ostrich with your head in the sand, having knowledge and awareness and being able to speak up. But I think that's an important part of why these conversations are important for parents. So they're not, they can speak against and to and for their position in a way that's knowledgeable, because it's exponentially spreading. The numbers of people that are becoming aware is exponentially spreading, which is why I believe these conversations are so important. And, you know, you talk about in your book, and you make it very simple, you talk about herd immunity and informed consent. Talk about that a little bit.
Yeah, it's two concepts that are super important. So informed consent, you have to have the right to be able to decline an intervention to truly be informed. So when you undergo a procedure, no matter what it is, you need to know what the pros are of having that intervention, what the cons are of having that intervention, and then what if I do nothing? What does that look like? And when you go and you show up at an appointment, all you're hearing now is that they're safe and effective, safe and effective, safe and effective. Like, that's all we hear. We don't hear how safe, how effective, and how long did we study it? What happens if my kid doesn't get the chickenpox vaccine? Like, walk me down worst case scenario with that. Like, she gets the chickenpox.
And that information doesn't exist.
No. So it's crazy. But like, let's say my kid gets the chickenpox. Yes, there are some scary things where you can have some neurologic trauma later in life. I get that. But also, what's the worst case scenario if she has the vaccine? Well, death from that as well. And so there's two polarizing sides to it, but you only hear one, or you just hear this information of authority that they're safe and effective. And it's, how long did we study it? And what were we looking for? Who were your trial participants? Because now there's so much exclusion criteria on trial participants, we don't put it to the general population. So informed consent is just something that is so important that you can't touch another human without their consent in any way, shape, or form. And that is true for vaccines. And now that we've started taking away personal belief exemptions, that negates the entire platform of informed consent, which medicine stands for. And so it's just so important that we do not let these rights start to slip away, because they will be impossible to get back. And if you think it only stands to vaccines, then we're deluded, because it's going to start going through all aspects of medicine. And once they start to control what happens to your body, we've lost it all. What's the point of the rest of it? And so we need to be able to know our pros, cons, and if we did nothing, what happens?
I think those are great questions, by the way. How safe and how effective for your pediatrician? I think that's a great question, and they should be able to answer it. And, you know, the other piece about informed consent, for those of you that aren't aware of where informed consent came out of, that concept came out of the Nuremberg trials after World War II, when Nazi Germany, doctors who went on trial, the doctor's trial, because these were the German doctors that were injecting people with all kinds of chemicals to see how they would react. And there was no informed consent in the time. And some of these doctors after World War II at the Nuremberg trials got sentenced to death and actually were put to death for crimes against humanity. And what I always find very interesting, I have chills when I think about it. When I went to Israel, and I talked about this with Del Bigtree, at one point when I interviewed him, we had a great conversation, and it was on one of the interviews that we did, is that these people, when I'm in Israel, there's a Holocaust museum, it's called Yad Vashem, and it's a magnificent tribute to this horrific act in history. And there's a hall of names, they call it, where you look up and you see this, all these images, pictures that they recovered from all these people that were killed in the Holocaust. And what really got me, and it still gets me today every time I think about this, a lot of these people were dressed in suits and ties and educators. They were accountants and lawyers and doctors and business people and entrepreneurs of the day. And they just complied. They did not ask the questions. They're like, oh, this can't be happening. There's no way this could be happening. And yes, it happened. It's one of the most horrific times in our history. And some of the policies that we are seeing being set for us as families are the same policies that put sentenced doctors to death in the Nuremberg trials. And here's the case, Caitlin, you probably know this, but the case was the United States of America versus the doctors. That was the name of the cases. And here we are, the United States of America, looking to make these mandates that they put people to death for. That almost makes me want to rip my hair out.
I hear you on all that. It's such important information to know. And the history of all this, like this isn't a new fight that we're fighting. So this has been going on for a long time. And we need to be aware and be attentive to the conditioning that we're having done to us as society to try and make it easier to swallow that our rights are being taken away. And we just can't. We have to stand and we have to stop. And even with my advocacy for vaccines, for a long time I was silent because I didn't want to hear the ridicule or have people judge me, or I don't know. You just get so much pushback. I'm like, do I want to deal with that? And then one morning I woke up and I'm like, if I don't stand, who's going to do it? And if I don't do it today, who's going to do it? And so it's that, if not me, who? And if not now, when? And I just couldn't be someone who sat on the sidelines anymore, because I needed someone to advocate for me at a time and I had a hard time finding it. And so we just need more people to stand up so you can find other people that are willing to answer your questions and point you in the right direction and show you the books that you can read and the organizations you can follow. And Zen Honeycutt was paramount in my ability to be able to make a big difference. And I showed up at the Capitol and she was there, and I had started with her Moms Across America calls. And so I was kind of getting familiar with her there, and I showed up at the Capitol and she's like, let's go talk to some legislators. And she just grabbed my hand and we walked into the Capitol, and I'm like, can we do this? Like, yeah, we can.
Yeah. Well, that's the good news, right? Is being able to be a part of groups that are growing, like Moms Across America, like National Vaccine Information Center. I mean, there's a lot of support out there once you realize, you know what, I'm going to get in this battle here because I love my child. I care about my child. I know I'm going to be the one stuck with the consequences of my choices, and I don't want my child to be the stuck with the consequences of my ignorance.
Right.
Which is, you know, now, you know, there's a lot of money in keeping alive neurologically damaged children for 80 years. There's a lot of money in that. And so, you know, that's another conversation for another day. But as a little plug, on the third Monday of every every month moving forward, we're going to do a call with Moms Across America for the public to talk about this issue and all kinds of holistic health issues that are relevant that parents are seeking out answers to. So everybody who's listening to this podcast, join us on that call. I mean, they do a call every week. I'm going to be specifically on those calls on the third Monday of every month. So we'd love to have you there so that we can empower you, that you can feel empowered. Bring your friends, bring everybody you know. It'll be like a Zoom party online. But you'll realize also when you attend those that you're not alone. And so talk to me a little bit about herd immunity and how viruses and bacteria adapt. And then I'll give my 2 cents on that too, because I think it's important to give parents confidence in the body's ability to adapt.
Absolutely. And just to play on that, I think having confidence in your own body is the first thing we need to do when talking about any of this. The human body is extraordinarily intelligent, and we are meant to be exposed to viruses and bacteria. And we're composed of a lot of viruses and bacteria. And now they're so
similar. Trillions of them.
Trillions, yes. But it, especially in these times, have become such a scary word that we are scared of bacteria and viruses, and we wouldn't live without them in our body. We would not have an immune system. We wouldn't have anything. We wouldn't function. We would not be alive as humans if it weren't for viruses and bacteria. They are extraordinarily important to us and our health and our well-being. But when it comes to herd immunity, which is the biggest thing that someone will start to talk to you about when you start to question vaccines, is like, what about the herd? We need to protect. We need to do this. And there's quite a few points on herd immunity. Well, first of all, it goes back to, are vaccines safe and effective, and what is our efficacy rate? And so herd immunity is the principle that if you have, it's generally believed to be 95%, sometimes 90%, but if you have 95% of the population vaccinated or immune against a disease, it will not spread throughout that population. So we can protect the 5% that are not immune, because everyone around you will be protected, and we can keep society safer, stronger, healthier as a whole, because a disease won't go through the population. So how do you get 95% herd immunity? Well, we went to vaccinations, but we need a vaccine that is 95% effective, and we don't have one on the market that is 95% effective to date.
And so let me ask you about that, because I'm sure that you know this. How many studies have been done on vaccinated children to show that the vaccines that they received actually gave them immunity?
Zero.
Okay, so can you repeat that, please? Because it's a very large number. I think there's a lot of commas inside of that number that you just said. So I'm going to ask it again. How many studies, because they're mandating this, right? So you think there's like a million studies on this. How many studies have been done that have tested children before and after they received the vaccine to show that the vaccine actually gave them immunity?
Zero.
Zero.
And you can put as many zeros behind it as you want.
Okay, so it could be a lot of zeros, a lot of commas. There's not a one, it's zero. That zero is the part that makes everybody like you and me crazy. Mm-hmm. This is like this grand, big assumption that there is zero evidence of this being effective, yet we are mandating it and we are harming children like crazy. People ask me all the time, you know, hey, we need evidence. Where's the evidence? I'll tell you where the evidence is that it's a problem, and that is in homes all across this country with neurologically damaged children that were not neurologically damaged before they received vaccines. And so you know, you talk about, and listen, we have a common background. Your husband's a chiropractor. I've been a practicing chiropractor for 35 years. We've taken care of thousands and thousands of families. We've trained thousands of chiropractors around the world through the 100-Year Lifestyle in our organization. And so we know that we're reproducing results and helping people, watching people's own bodies heal and the miracle of healing that we have inside of us because of the power of our innate intelligence. So talk about that a little bit more when it comes to immunity, because isn't it true if bacteria and viruses adapt that human beings can also adapt? And that's what we see. That's why we get these antibodies.
Yeah, absolutely. And so herd immunity and the body, I mean, bacteria and viruses, they need hosts in order to thrive, or an environmental situation that nothing can live without the harmony of everything else in the world. And the universe is so intelligent that we are able to all live in this world, in this planet, and thrive synonymously because we need each other to survive. And the same is true for viruses and bacteria. And when it comes to something like pediatric vaccinations, we often look at the chickenpox vaccine and like, why was that created? And oftentimes the creators say, well, because I could. And it's like, okay, well, so then we take chickenpox out of the pediatric population. And then what have we seen happen? Well, you can still get chickenpox from the chickenpox vaccine because it's a live virus. And so it says if you have less than 50, you know, dots come up that you don't actually have it, but you can still get chickenpox from the chickenpox vaccine. But so we've taken chickenpox out of society. And so now we have seen an increase in our elderly population of, oh my gosh, it's just, help me out here.
Measles?
No.
Shingles.
Thank you. Jeez, that slipped my mind. So now we're seeing an uptick in shingles because we're not having these generations exposed to the chickenpox virus. When a kid gets the chickenpox and the parents and the grandparents are around it, then it increases their own immune response to keep them protected from chickenpox and also suppress shingles. And so now we see this big uptick in shingles because we've taken away chickenpox in the pediatric population. We also have shown that when kids have these viruses or get exposed to bacteria and we challenge their immune system, it is extraordinarily beneficial for them in order to have a functioning immune system. And we can't sterilize the world and think that our body is going to function when we are composed of viruses and bacteria. And so when we start to remove these, then we start to see other ramifications where we have a really sick pediatric population. Like our kids are not healthy. They're not thriving. They can't handle, you know, being exposed to dirt and viruses because we haven't seeded their immune system to be able to do so. And so we give a vaccine and we think it's going to be effective, and they show on paper that, oh, well, it has an 80% efficacy rate. Well, you'll never hit herd immunity, which they propose is 95%. So that argument's out the window. Also, viruses are changing and manipulating all the time, which we see with the HPV vaccine, where we used to protect against 4 strains in the virus, and then we had to up it, and we upped it again. And same thing with Prevnar and pneumonia. We start with certain strains and then the viruses mutate because they know how to live in their new environment. And so we have to, we're always chasing this adaptation that's happening, and we'll never catch up to it because nature will always outsmart us and nature will always try and put itself in homeostasis. And
so nature will always be ahead of us, always.
Always.
Yeah.
We will never outsmart nature. But
yeah, we had a patient just last week that came in and told us that one of his coworkers went and got the shingles vaccine and ended up that night going to the hospital, spent 2 days in the hospital, almost died from that vaccine. And here's the thing, you know, I was, I gave a talk, I was on a panel session at the Florida Chiropractic Association at their state convention just recently. And the topic was medical errors in children. And what really hit a lot of the doctors that were there is that these reactions that we're talking about, they're not even considered medical errors. These are just normal reactions that they expect to normal protocols and procedures. They are not considered medical errors. When you start to factor that in, it really kind of gets overwhelming to be with concern about all of these things. And so, wow, we can go on for hours. So herd immunity, right? We can keep going. So I want to move, let's get on the positive side. So get this book, by the way, it's Safe and Effective, Why Medical Freedom is Worth Fighting For. I think it's worth fighting for. I definitely am in the movement in the world that we have created with the 100-Year Lifestyle, our network of doctors around the country, where you were fortunate to find one of them in Northern California. You can find them in probably 26 states right now. We're adding people all the time. And so talk to me about, real quick, what do you do with moving forward? So what are some of your suggestions moving forward so that parents, when they leave this call, or this podcast, this interview that you and I have done here, and we'll probably do another one. What do you suggest that people do?
And this is the question I get most often, and it's so important because as a mom, if you're sitting at home, you're like, I can't change the world. I'm just one person. I can't do this. I can't do that. But there are lots of things that we can do. And the biggest thing is to educate yourself, because you need to be able to have a calm and confident conversation with somebody when the situation arises. You don't need to walk around the jungle gym or the park and tell every mom that you see all of your thoughts and feelings all the time, because I don't think that's going to be productive and it'll be exhausting. But you need to be educated so you can have clear and concise conversations with people when the situation arises. And I think the best way to do that is to read your books, have your background knowledge, and then I think you can contribute to this more, but there's three main organizations that I think are doing really great things for, actually. Moms Across America, which I work with them a lot, and I'm on those calls that you mentioned, and they do great advocacy, and they put out campaigns. One just went out yesterday, the 10 reasons why not to mandate the COVID vaccine. I helped contribute to that, and I think it's really important that we get these documents signed, because these are going to all the state governors. And so you as a parent can sign this information that comes out from Moms Across America. Children's Health Defense is another organization I stand behind. It's Robert F. Kennedy Jr.'s organization, and they have a team of lawyers, and his goal was to create an organization where it is solely their job to watch legislation and fight it. And currently the UC system in California is trying to mandate the flu vaccine. Well, they're the organization that's putting the injunction, stopping this stuff, and actively has the legal power to fight. So supporting them either by, again, supporting their campaigns, which they put out to sign, monetarily supporting them, or somebody else that's putting this information out. So Children's Health Defense, support them. Del Bigtree is huge at being able to captivate an audience, and he does the high wire. And so following his information and being able to share and disseminate his information as it comes, I think is huge. And then Barbara Lowe Fisher's organization, I think, is kind of the fourth leader putting out content that actually has the power to make a change. And so supporting these organizations and following them is going to give them the power to fight big pharma. Because is it one mom that's going to change, can take on, you know, Moderna or any of these companies? No, but together, when we band together and grow this movement one person at a time, that's how we do it. So we support the organizations, and then we as moms, we talk to as many people as we can, because you're smart and you're educated and you can find this information, and we need to be able to share it compassionately, because so many people just say, I didn't know to question it. I didn't know to think differently. I wish I had known. I had no idea. And so you just have to spark a little bit of curiosity in somebody's mind to make them go down that rabbit hole. I don't think reciting the facts and figures is going to change their mind, but like, oh, did you hear about this? Or have you read this book? Is just a way for them to start to peruse that information on their own. And then once you start to learn one thing, you can't unlearn it, and you're going to want to know more.
Yeah. And I think that's great. And we have interviews with three of the four people that you just mentioned, Barbara and Dell, and with Zen and Moms Across America. And so, I mean, they're doing so much. Go to their websites. They're doing amazing things. If you want to get a quick, very similar type, but different spin on it conversation, go to those podcasts and interviews that we have as well. They're available on 100YearLifestyle.com. And so I think those are really important. And I really believe that we need to walk in and ask these questions to our pediatricians. Get a little education under your belt, and don't be afraid to question your pediatrician, because I do believe that at some point, if we had 1,000 people listen to this, or 5,000 people listen to this, and every one of you parents went in tomorrow, made an appointment, and questioned your pediatrician, they might throw the first one of us out or the second one of us out, but really it would chop down their confidence and get them to wake up. And we need to chop down their confidence just being puppets of the pharmaceutical industry and this vaccine industry. And so I love what you're doing. I love the strength and conviction that you bring. I love that you're married to a colleague, a fellow chiropractor. Barbara Lo Fisher, she's been a friend for more than 35 years. And she said to me, when I was just on their NBIC conference, I was honored to speak there. And she said, you know, the chiropractors always show up.
They do.
The chiropractors always show up. And even way back when, they always showed up. And so, you know what? Thank you for showing up. Thank you for showing up strong, so much conviction and so much good information. Please get Caitlin's book, Safe and Effective, Why Medical Freedom is Worth Fighting For. And if you lose it in the United States of America, you will have no place else on earth to go. My dear listeners, colleagues, friends, you will have no place else to go. So now is the time for the battle. Caitlin, thank you for being a warrior. How can people contact you?
Yeah, so I do through my book or through my website. And so I don't know if you have show notes, but we can add it there if we want to. But yeah, so I can add those in there. My book's on Amazon, and then my website, because I do consult with families. If you're having a hard time and you don't know how to navigate this journey, I'm always there for those people. Because again, I just feel like people need an advocate, and you can find that a million different ways, but I'm there for people that need it. So we will put my website up there, but CaitlinMcCormick.com. And I also want to thank you. You have done so much work, and you reach so many people, and you never shy away from a conversation or a discussion. And it's so important to have people that are willing to have a dialogue and push boundaries and make people think differently. And I mean, just the 100-year lifestyle does that, and it pushes people beyond what they know that they're capable of doing. And I think that's extraordinarily important. And I just commend you for all the work that you've done in that regard.
Thank you. It's an honor. We are just getting started, and more passionate about what we're doing more than ever. I always say that, you know, if you're a warrior, you hate this battle, but you love the battle. Thank you for being that warrior. And thank you, everybody, for being those warriors, for listening, for sharing this, one of the most important, I believe, messages that you're going to hear anywhere to give you confidence and great resources. Simple. Get involved, get going, and thanks for being a part of the journey. So, Caitlin, have a great rest of the day, and love and appreciate you all. Here's to 100% for 100 years, everybody. Dr. Eric Plaschka with Caitlin McCormick signing out.